Praise the Lord!
Praise the Lord!
Praise the Most High God!
Praise the Most High God!
And welcome to this special service on Palm Sunday in the year 2017. And welcome to my television audience, YouTube audience, and any other audience, and anyone who would be hearing this word. Today is Palm Sunday, April 9th, 2017. You know, my heart is saddened before I begin this message because today in Egypt, once again, a certain religious group called Islam sought opportunity to murder about 45 Christians in two separate attacks in Cairo, Egypt. They maximized this because they knew on Palm Sunday, many Christians will gather together to worship the Lord Jesus Christ. Dearly beloved, if you're listening well and if you really want truth, please understand that what you see happen, what happened or what occurred a few hours ago in Egypt will continue to occur until Messiah comes, until the King of the Jews returns, until the King of the universe returns. Amen. Because that's what the Bible says. Here at Ambassadors for Christ Ministries, we make no apologies for stating very categorically and dogmatically and yet with humility, this is the only book we believe in. Amen. When I say the only book we believe in matters of theology. Amen? So take this book in your right hand or whatever hand you have and say it with me, this is the Word of God.
This is the Word of God.
I believe it.
I believe it.
I will study it.
I will study it.
I will teach it.
I will teach it.
I will preach it.
I will preach it.
And I will live by it.
I will live by it.
For the glory of Yeshua.
For the glory of Yeshua.
Amen. 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 So yes, it's a wonderful time across the world for Christians. And yet the reality is, even as we commemorate Christ 2,000 years ago, it's not that wonderful for the Christians, the millions that are suffering persecution. You know, in this Holy Week, Passover Week, depending whatever terminology you wish to use, while we commemorate the glorious event of the resurrection of Christ, before the resurrection there was much suffering. Christians, before our day of glory, there is much suffering. And the suffering continues. My title for the message today is Hail Yeshua, King of the Jews. Hail Jesus, King of the Jews. For the benefit of anyone who's hearing me for the first time, I often use the name Yeshua because that's his correct name. So when you hear me say Yeshua, I mean Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Hail Yeshua, King of the Jews. Now where do I take that from? Well, from the Bible. So open your Bibles with me, please, to Matthew 27. Matthew 27. It is the last week of the life of Christ. I want to put this in historical perspective. So this is a historical event that occurred. Whether or not somebody believes this occurred does not change the fact that it occurred. Praise God. In other words, you can revise history. You can choose not to believe it, but you're choosing not to believe something that was real or is real doesn't change the reality of the thing. 2,000 years ago, there was a man who walked this earth. The God-man, Jesus the Christ, Yeshua. 2,000 years ago, he was arrested, instigated and incited by the Jews, the Roman authorities decided he would be crucified. That's fact. That's not make-believe. That's documentable. Hallelujah. Amen. Now what happened? Well, I want to pick up the story here with the soldiers. Chapter 27 of Matthew, verse 27. This is where my key scripture is today, my theme. Verse 27, I read, then the soldiers of the governor, keep in mind the soldiers of the governor. Who was the governor? Pilate. He was Roman. He was representing the Roman government. But Christ had been delivered to Pilate by the very Jews. Christ himself was a Jew. The soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the praetorium. So that's the special house of the governor. He lived in the praetorium, special place. And gathered the whole garrison around him. And they stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. I will explain all of that in a few minutes. When they had twisted a crown of thorns, they put it on his head and a reed in his right hand. And they bowed the knee before him and mocked him, saying, Hail, King of the Jews. Hail, King of the Jews. Oh yeah, they did that in mockery. They did that contemptuously. But little did they realize, or if at all, that wording, Hail King of the Jews, is real. Yeshua is the King of the Jews. But more than that, Yeshua is the King of the universe.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. And unless you understand and believe, you have no life in you. But let's put this in historical perspective. You know, what was funny is a few days before this event, Christ was making his grand entrance into the city of Jerusalem. That's recorded for us in Matthew 21. So we're going to open our Bibles. Always remember here, Ambassadors for Christ Ministries, our Bible is our authority. Amen? I don't care what the Pope says. I'm sorry if I offend you. But then again, I don't live to offend you or not offend you. I live to speak the truth.
Amen?
Amen? I don't care what some famous pastor says. I go only by the Bible. Hallelujah. I have learned in my life journey of being a pastor for 35 plus years, when I stick with the Bible, I can't go wrong. Amen?
Amen.
I don't go by somebody's popular theology or popular book or what's the consensus of the majority opinion of the nation. Oh, no, 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 no. No, it is, and no, it never will be. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Matthew 21, here's what we read. Verse 1. Now, when they drew near Jerusalem, that's Jesus, he was coming to Jerusalem. This was going to be his grand entrance, his final visit to the city to which one day he shall return. May I be very clear that Jerusalem, Yerushalayim, belongs to the Jews. More correctly, Yerushalayim belongs to the God of the Jews.
Amen.
And he gives it to whomsoever he wishes.
Yes.
It never was, is not, and never shall belong to the Muslims.
Right.
Let's get that very clear. So when they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples saying to them, go into the village opposite, and immediately you'll find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Loose them and bring them to me. And if anyone says anything to you, you shall say, the Lord has need of them. And immediately he will send them. So Christ, being God, already had arranged that. I don't know how, nor do I need to know how. He is God, right? He can arrange things like that. Hallelujah.
Amen.
All this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying, so this is what the prophets have prophesied. You have to keep in mind, when you're studying the New Testament, church, and the people out there, understand this. When you study the New Testament, you must understand it in the context of the Old. Amen?
Amen?
Because a lot of what took place, as recorded by Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, many of these events were actually prophesied to occur concerning the Christ. So tell the daughter of Zion, so we're speaking of the Israelites, the daughter of Zion, these are the Jews, God's chosen covenant nation. Behold, your king is coming to you. Your king. Now keep this in mind. They had expected a king to come. As the story unfolds here, we must keep in mind that the Jewish people, Israel, they were no longer a free nation. At the time, 2,000 years ago, they were a subjugated people under the Roman government. But they had known the prophets. The prophets had prophesied that one day a deliverer will come. One day a new king will come, greater than King David, greater than King Solomon, greater than all the other kings. And that king will give them true deliverance. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So the prophecy was, behold, your king is coming to you. Yes, the prophets had prophesied that a king was coming to them, lowly and sitting on a donkey. A colt, the foal of a donkey. So this was prophesied in Zechariah and Isaiah. Now, knowing that prophecy, the authorities could have said, you know what, this man really is the deliverer, he really is the Messiah. Or they could have gone against it, which is what they did. But let's follow the story. Verse 6. So the disciples went and they did as Jesus commanded them. They brought the donkey and the colt, laid their clothes on them. So here are the disciples. They obeyed the rabbi. They go get the donkey, the two animals, the donkey and the colt. They lay their clothes on the donkey's back. They decorate this donkey. They adorn this donkey because the disciples know that this Jesus, this Yeshua, is indeed the Messiah. He's indeed the King of the Jews. Amen?
Amen.
So they gave him the best treatment they could give, the royal treatment, that is. So they brought the donkey and the colt, laid their clothes on them, and set him on them. And a very great multitude. Don't miss this. This wasn't the 12 disciples here. This wasn't just as regular people. A great multitude did something. Spread their clothes on the road. So they must have taken out some of the outer garments that they were wearing and spread them on the road. This was to honor him. This was because they thought he is the king of Israel. He is the king of the Jews. This was their red carpet treatment. Even though Yeshua was in a donkey, not a white horse. Jesus' last visit, funny thing is this, Jesus' last visit to Jerusalem was on a lowly, humble donkey. His next visit to Jerusalem will be on a great, powerful white horse. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise his holy name. A heavenly one, not one that's bred by anybody here. God will take care of that. That's all right. So what did the multitude do? They spread their clothes on the road. Others cut on branches. That's why it's called Palm Sunday. They cut down branches and they were waving the branches and spread them on the road. Then the multitudes, here comes the real clincher. I love this one. The multitudes. Now, figure with me. A multitude doesn't mean 25 people, all right? A multitude means hundreds, maybe thousands of people. Yeah. Now, why can I say that? It was Passover season. What do you think happened during Passover season? Thousands of Jews would converge in the city of Jerusalem because it was a command. So thousands went before, and those who followed him cried. So here was this great procession. Christ is on the donkey with his disciples. He's leading the procession, and others are putting the branches, and some are following behind. And what are they shouting? Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Now, technically, the word Hosanna means save now. Even though it's used as a form of praise, Hosanna is a form of praise, but it technically means save now. So what are they saying? Two things they're saying. One, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. He's the Son of David. They knew prophetically that this man riding that donkey on that day, on Palm Sunday, was the Son of David, was the prophesied Messiah, was the prophesied deliverer, was the one who would come and reestablish the greatness of the kingdom of Israel. So they were blessing him. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. The word Lord is capitalized. That refers to Yahweh. He is the God. I want to make that very clear. Once again, for the benefit of my audience in TV land, whenever in the Bible you see the word capitalized L-O-R-E, that refers to the sacred name of our God, Yahweh, Y-H-V-H. Our God has a name. As I have often preached and I will always preach, the God of the Christians has a name. The God of the Jews has a name. He's the same God, Y-H-V-H. Amen. Blessed is he who comes in the name of Yahweh. Hosanna in the highest. Save us now. Here's the problem. The multitudes wanted to be saved at that moment because they were still under Roman government. They were no longer a sovereign, independent nation. And you know, look around at the world. Nobody wants to be governed by another nation. We all want independence. Unfortunately, most nations that get independence mess up big time because the devil is in the details. All right? Unfortunately. So they said, save us now. They realized that they wanted a savior. And yes, believe it or not, Yeshua had come to save them. But the salvation he was going to offer them on that week was not the salvation they were looking for. Are we listening now?
Yeah.
Everybody thinks of salvation in a sense of, I want a physical deliverer. I want somebody to just make my life very easy and comfortable and everything should be fine. Yes, he had come to save them, but not according to their wishes, not according to their plan. When he had come into Jerusalem, all the city. So now he's entering into the city. The whole city is moved. The word has spread. Everybody said, guess what? Yeshua is in town. He is the Son of David. He is somebody special. And then people are asking, well, who is this? You know, the pilgrims might have been asking, who is this? Why is this big crowd gathering here? Why are they waving palms? Why are they throwing their clothes on the road? And their response collectively was, so the multitude said, this is Yeshua, the prophet from Nazareth of Galilee. Yeah. So prophetically, they understood something. From the Tanakh, the Old Testament, they knew he was not an ordinary man. Something was uniquely different about this man. Yes, he is the King of Kings. Yes, he is the Lord of Lords. But they didn't fully understand it. Now, why is all of this important? Because, brethren, those of you listening to me, the same multitudes who on Sunday, the same multitudes who on Sunday, which begins the final week of his life, who took off their coats and spread them on the streets, who cut down the palm branches and put them on the streets, who waved the palm branches, the same multitude a few days later would be shouting, "Release Barabbas and crucify Jesus." My, how human beings can change. Pause and think with me. You know why they would have changed? Because he didn't meet their expectations. They had boxed him in. They wanted him to be what they wanted him to be. They had missed exactly what God was doing. Had they really studied the scriptures carefully, they would have known something else, right?
Yeah.
But a lot of us today still miss the point. And I don't want to get into all the political foolishness that's taking place in the world, but please understand that everything that is happening in the world ultimately leads to one final thing, the return of the Messiah.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
And when Messiah comes, he is not coming on a colt or a donkey. He is not coming as a baby to be wrapped in swaddling cloths. He is not coming to be paraded throughout the streets as a criminal. He is not coming to die on a cross. He is coming as the mighty conquering King of Kings.
Right.
Hallelujah.
Glory.
And the world can say what they want. And all the governments and all the UN can say what they want. He is coming to conquer and to rule forever. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah.
Glory.
Hallelujah. Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Yes, he's coming back. Glory to God. So what happens? Well, you know, all of this stuff takes place on Sunday, Monday, Tuesday. Time goes on. Let's pick up the story now in Matthew 27, which I began with. Matthew chapter 27. So you know how the crowds turned against him? And they said to Pilate, no, we don't want this Jesus be released. Let's crucify Christ. Let's release Barabbas, the murderer. So the multitudes who at one breath a few days ago said, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. This is Yeshua the prophet. This is this great deliverer." The same multitudes, or many of them, said to Pilate, "Let's kill him. Let's crucify him. Release the murderer, the terrorists, the insurrectionists, Barabbas." And so they delivered him into the hands of Pilate. The worst was yet to come. Christ's final week of life. Now let me say this before I go in there. Please understand that any time during that final week, Yeshua could have decided that he was going to take care of this problem once and for all by killing them all.
Yep.
He's God. Remember what he told Peter? "Don't you know I have the power to command angels?" Jesus said to Peter, "Don't you know, Peter, I have the power to command legions of angels? I can only speak the word, and they will bow down to me, and they will come here, and they will destroy everyone against me."
Amen.
That's power.
Yep.
Which president or prime minister or king has that power?
None.
Christ had that power then, and he still has that power today. Amen?
Amen.
That's why Christians should lift up their heads and rejoice.
Amen.
No matter what happens.
Yep.
No matter what happens. This is a week for us, not to be sad, but a week to rejoice.
Amen.
Because of what Christ came to accomplish then, and the purposes will finally will culminate in his glorious return. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So, let's pick it up in verse 27. Then the soldiers of the governor, so these are now the Roman soldiers. So the Jews have done their part, they have welcomed him in Jerusalem, and then they have betrayed him. Welcome, and then betrayal. Seems like human beings, huh? Typical human behavior. We welcome you, we give you a hug, and we kiss you, and then we put a knife in your back.
Yeah.
The soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the praetorium and gathered the whole garrison around him. They stripped him. Now, the stripping here was, look at the purpose. Follow the logic here. We must know the word of God. They stripped him to do what? To put a scarlet robe on him. They were now going to make fun of him as king. You see, kings wear scarlet robes. Right? Robes. Gold robes, scarlet robes, highly decorated robes. So they put a scarlet robe on him, and when they twisted a crown. So now the Roman soldiers make a crown of thorns. Not a crown of jewels and diamonds and golds and no, a crown of thorns. And they stuck it into his head. And as they plunged the crown of thorns down his head, across his face, the blood began to spill down. What evil had Jesus done? None. What evil had Yeshua done? None. He simply represented God the Father. Are you getting it today?
Yeah.
I told you that just today, a few hours ago, two Christian churches in Egypt were attacked by Muslims. Again. Muslims. Again. Muslims. Again. Muslims. Again. They do it all the time. All across North Africa. All across the Middle East. Christian churches are being persecuted. Christians are being persecuted. Churches are being burned out. Christ is still being persecuted, you know.
Yes.
So the Roman soldiers did what? They put a scarlet robe on him and they plunged that crown of thorns upon his head. And then they give him a reed, you know, the kingly reed to hold in his right hand. All in contempt and mockery. And they bow the knee before him. Yeah, they bow the knee before him. Contemptuously, with derision, scorn. And they mocked him. And they said, "Hail, King of the Jews." You could see the disgust and the contempt in their hearts. You could listen to their voices. "Hey, King of the Jews, you think you are the king, huh? Well, we'll show you who's the boss around here, huh? Get that into your head." Yeah, when you don't know God, it's a horrible thing not to know God.
Amen.
Let me tell you something, church, and listen well, and those of you in my television audience. Every time a Muslim or communist or whoever kills a Christian, you are killing Christ.
Yes.
Did you hear what I said?
Yes.
You're being one of the Roman soldiers.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You're putting a crown of thorns upon that Christian's head. Yep. Yep. It's happening all over the world. Every day it's happening again. The sacrifice of Christ. Yeah. Christ paid the ultimate. And he said to his disciples, don't forget what he said. He said, "If they persecute me, they will persecute you also." Right?
Yep.
So they mock him. "Hail, King of the Jews." Come on. But even more disgusting and pathetic, they spat on him. You know, it's a great insult to spit on a man and slap a man. To spit on the creator of the universe. To spit on the very God who had made them. To spit on the very God who had given them wives and children. Do we understand?
Yeah.
The world laughs at our God. The world still laughs at Jesus Christ today. In America, the liberals and the Democrats and all the other, the atheists and so many others, they laugh at the name of Christ. I'm telling you, your day for laughter will soon end.
Amen.
And then you will cry. But your cries will not be heard by anyone.
Right. Yeah,
weeping and gnashing of teeth. Yes. They spat on him. They took the reed and struck him on the head with it. And when they had mocked him, they took back the robe and put back his own clothes and led them away to be crucified. Church, it is important. Christians, on this Holy Week, it is important for you to grasp the enormity of what Christ went through and not take it for granted. You know, there is a religion of 1.6 billion people who hate the name of Jesus. Oh, you will say to me, "Pastor, that's not true." It is true.
Yeah.
The Jesus they say they honor is not the Jesus of the Bible. Their Isa is not my Yeshua.
Right.
Their Isa was never crucified.
Right.
And their Isa was never resurrected. My Yeshua was crucified for them and for me.
Amen.
And my Yeshua is resurrected. And my Yeshua is ascended. And my Yeshua is at the right hand of God the Father, waiting to return as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Hallelujah. Let's get that straight. So don't give me your bologna, because I don't eat bologna. I eat clean food. No bologna for me. Yes, it was the most horrible week of Christ's life. But let's remember that Christ had come for that. It wasn't like they sprung a surprise. Oops, I got hooked on this one. How did this happen? No, this was the moment he knew it exactly. This is what would happen, because that was already previously discussed between himself and his Father.
Amen.
This was the week he It wasn't going to be the week next year or the week the year before. This was it. Amen? Did we get it?
Yeah.
All planned out by the living God. See, the living God is very living. For you atheists who don't believe in a God, one day you will believe in a God. Listen to me. One day you will believe in a God.
Yes.
But the day you believe in that God might be too late for you.
Yeah. Right.
Right.
I want to just warn everybody listening to my message. Every human being one day will believe in God.
Yes.
But the problem is that the majority who will believe in God will already be in hell when they believe in God.
Amen.
So at that point, your belief in God has no value. But you will know that the God you rejected today, that the God you spat upon, that the God you struck on his head, that the God you mocked and scourged, that the God you said the nastiest things to, you will know that God is real.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Glory.
So let's continue with the story and event here. Verse 32. As they came out, they found a man of Cyrene, Simon by name, him they compelled to bear his cross. And when they had come to a place called Golgotha, that is to say the place of the skull, they gave him, that is Christ, sour wine mingled with gall to drink. But when he had tasted it, he would not drink it. Then they crucified him and divided his garments, casting lots, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet. They divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. Sitting down, they kept watch over him. I guess they didn't want him to leave the cross, right? Well, I guess they were scared. So they sat there to see what would happen. And they put up over his head the accusation written against him. Here is what, this is most amazing in a way. What was the accusation? They put that in big bold letters up above his head. And here's what it read. This is Yeshua, Jesus, the King of the Jews. Now that is not circumstantially coincidental. That was deliberate. God wanted that to happen.
Amen.
Every person that week who would pass by would see, this is Yeshua, the King of the Jews. It will leave etch something in their minds.
Yep.
That man in the middle is who? Yeshua, the King of the Jews. My king is dead. Huh. One day when he returns, that memory will come back.
Amen.
Are we listening?
Yeah.
The two robbers were crucified with him, one on the right and one on the left. I'll get back to those robbers in a short while and when we go to the book of Luke, but let's stick with the Matthew account now. Verse 39. And those who passed by, now get the scenario. So here is Yeshua in the middle. One thief on one side, the other thief on the other side. Two thieves who rightfully were supposed to be, you know, executed. But Christ had done nothing wrong. His only wrong was that he had come to die. He had come to pay the price. There's nothing wrong. He had come to die. And the devil had used the best resources he could, the Jews and the Romans conspiring together to make it happen. Now, here he is still alive on the cross. It would take some time for him to completely die. And those who passed by blasphemed him, wagging their heads. Huh. Think of this. I don't know exactly what they did, but wagging your heads and saying, you will destroy the temple and build it in 3 days. Save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross. Huh? What people don't get is that, brothers and sisters and those, listen to me, Christ could have simply breathed death upon them. Instantaneously, Christ could have crushed every single one of these blasphemers. But he hadn't come to do that. Grace. As Christ lay on that cross dying, God the Father was administering grace to the world. God's grace. God's grace. Grace that's greater than our sin. Do we understand?
Yep.
How I grieve when I see what this world does to Christians. How I grieve when I see enlightened leaders, men and women with PhDs and doctoral degrees and university positions and high sounding whatever, they mock and scorn the Christ I worship, who is the God of the universe, who is the King over the Jews and the King over the whole world. I continue. Verse 41. Likewise, the priest, the chief priest. So here are the crowds. The crowds are mocking him. If you are the Christ, if you are the king, if you are so great, you are the Son of God. Huh? You're the Son of God? Prove you're the Son of God. Come on down. They had missed the point. The Son of God had come to be on the cross.
Amen.
The very ones who were blaspheming him, the very ones who were accusing him, the very ones who were mocking him contemptuously were the very ones he had come to save.
Yes.
Praise God. Amen. The chief priests mocking with the scribes and elders. These are the religious people. I have said before, and I'll say it again, and I wrote this in my book too, some of the worst human beings on the planet Earth are religious people. I repeat, some of the worst human beings on this earth are religious and people, including some Christians.
Yeah.
These were religious people. He saved others. Himself, he cannot save. If he is the king of Israel, if he is the king of Israel, let him come down now from the cross and we will believe him. Really? You know, I hear many people say to me, well, if Christ would prove himself, we would believe him. Oh, really? Christ already proved himself. Wasn't he crucified and didn't he resurrect 3 days later?
Yes.
And was he not ascended a few days later?
Yes,
what more evidence you want? I'll tell you what evidence you want. When you're in hell, you'll get the evidence. If he is the king of Israel, let him come down now from the cross and we will believe him. He trusted in God. Let God deliver him now, if he will have him. For he said, I am the Son of God. I want this to sink deeply into your hearts today, church. You know, it's nice to wave banners. It's nice to wave branches. Yeah. But don't forget, all of that waving doesn't change your heart. Don't forget, the very ones who waved those branches were the ones who delivered him to be crucified.
Yep.
I'll be listening.
Yep.
There are many religious people running around this world, Christians included. Oh, yeah. Not to mention the atheists and the liberals and the Muslims and the other people running around this world, and they're very pious looking as priests and elders and, you know, whatever terms they give themselves. And when they are doing their function, they look really holy and righteous. But their hearts are full of the devil.
Amen.
Are we listening?
Yes.
I'm not impressed by the clothing you wear, nor is God impressed by the clothing you wear and the special religious items. You know, there are these religious items you wear, and the color on the sleeve says you're higher level than the other one down there. You know, and you have more stripes. You might be getting more stripes here from the Lord when he beats your behind for your foolishness. We got to get facts right. I don't play pretend, nor does God. Listen, I want to be honest before God, do you?
Yes.
Amen. So they're mocking him. Even the robbers who were crucified with him reviled him. But actually not both robbers. Matthew just makes a general statement. Luke gives us more clarity on that point. So let's go to the book of Luke. Luke 23. This is what your Messiah suffered. This is Christ's final week. This is his sacrifice, his ultimate sacrifice for you and for me and for the rest of mankind. Luke 23, I begin in verse 26. Luke 23. There's some repetition here, but that's okay. Repetition is good. I want the message to sink into our hearts today. Amen?
Amen.
Verse 26. Now as they led him away, they laid hold of a certain man, Simon the Cyrenian, who was coming from the country, and on him they laid the cross that he might bear it after Jesus. And a great multitude of people followed him. Yes, there was a large procession to Golgotha, Calvary, the place of the skull. For those of you who have seen these movies, religious movies at this time, you see a struggling Christ as he's bearing that cross, and he's falling down until eventually this man, Simon of Cyrene, helps him. And you see them whipping Jesus along the path, whipping and tearing him apart. What had he done? You know, I'm sorry if anybody's offended, but that's the way the cookie crumbles. When I see and read what some people do to Christians today, whipping them, torturing them, and then beheading them, and they call themselves servants of some God, you are not a servant of God, you're a servant of Satan.
Yes.
Get that into your head. No servant of God will be doing that kind of torture and persecution of men of God. Do we understand?
Yes.
I'm sick and tired of all the baloney on this earth. Religious people, political people, people who think they are wise and they are smart. Do we understand?
Yeah.
Are you sick and tired of it?
Yeah.
Come, Lord Jesus, come and reign over this earth. Reign over the nations and show them your power as King and Lord and God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
He's coming again, and every eye shall see. Yes, and even those who pierced it, and they shall mourn. Do we understand the word of God?
Yes.
Yes. So they followed, and all these women were following. Big crowds. Here is Yeshua. He's going up the hill of Calvary to Golgotha, to the place where he's to be crucified. And he's struggling because his body is weakened by all the loss of blood and all the exhaustion and the heat of the day and all of that stuff. And all the mocking and scourging and laughs and scorn and everything else. He's bearing all of that shame as he walks up to Golgotha. All the world laughs at him. He says to the woman who were mourning and lamented. You know, the women generally tend to have a softer emotional disposition, and they're mourning, they can't understand. There is Mary, his mother, and all the other women perhaps who were his faithful followers during his 3 years of ministry. And they were wondering, how could this happen? How could this happen to a good man? He looked every reason to be the Messiah. A man who healed the sick, the blind, the deaf, the lame, the leper, whatever it was. Who wasn't afraid to touch lepers when the world scorned them? He would touch them. He would reach out to them. He would go into the gutter to be with them, to lift them up. So these women lamented and mourned. And then Christ turned to them and said, so in his weak state, he turned to them and said, daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. He wasn't being rude. He was giving them a prophecy here. Weep for yourselves, meaning, listen, what you don't know is that I came for this purpose. I came to die for you. It's okay, but now weep for yourselves. Here's why. For indeed the days are coming in which they will say, blessed are the barren wombs that never bore, and the breasts which never nursed. Then they'll begin to say to the mountains, fall on us, and to the hills, cover us. For if they do these things in the greenwood, what will be done in the dry? If this is done in the live season, what will be done in the dry season? Do we understand this?
Yes.
If Jesus, the living tree, hasn't been spared, can you imagine what will happen to the dead trees?
Yes.
This is Messiah's lament over the very nation of Israel, the very nation he had come to, the very people who had said, behold, this is Yeshua, the King. He says, daughters of Jerusalem, let me tell you what's going to happen. Now, for those who know history, exactly what he said would happen occurred 40 years later, or 37 years later, in the year AD 70, when the Roman armies came in, besieged the city of Jerusalem, burned down the temple, and killed almost all the Jews inside. Are we listening?
Yes.
Yeah. Lord help us. The world isn't listening. Satan has taken, it seems to me that the spirit of the devil has taken full control of the world now. The whole culture is perverted beyond measure. People can no longer think. Their minds are demented and demonized and everything else. But that's what the Lord said would occur before his return. Verse 32, there were two criminals led with him to be put to death. And when they come to the place called Calvary, there they crucified him. So here is Christ, and there are the criminals crucified. Then Jesus said, now here's the amazing presence of mind and the very purpose for which Christ had come. He now illustrates that by what he says. Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. How many of us have that ability? Let's be honest. No, church, let's be honest. Most of us, and I include myself, I don't think that's the first thing will come from our mouths. The first thing would be, get him! Kill him! Oh, God, kill them right now! Are we honest to accept that or not? Father, forgive them. You see, church, Christ had come to make forgiveness available to the world. And that forgiveness was illustrated by him actually asking God the Father to forgive the very ones who were blaspheming him, who were accusing him, who were nailing him to the cross. Forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. The world still doesn't know what it's doing because of the deception in the world.
Yeah.
This world, the Bible says in Revelation, I will not go there, the whole world is deceived. When you talk to people today, you realize how deceived they are, assuming that you're not deceived. If you know the Word of God, the world is deceived. If you don't know the Word of God, then you too are deceived. The only truth comes from this book. There is no other truth when it comes to spiritual and theological matters. There is only one truth. You can't have two truths that conflict with each other. And one of those truths is not a truth, it's a lie. It's the Word of God, the Bible. They divided his garments and cast lots, and the people stood looking on, but even the rulers sneered, saying, he save others, let him save himself, if he is the Christ, the chosen of God. The priests, the elders, the political rulers, the soldiers, and the multitudes. The whole world was against Christ on that day. Except for a few ladies here and there scattered in the crowd whose voices were drowned out by the sea of stupidity and hatred. Do we understand?
Yeah.
Those voices couldn't prevail. And even if they did prevail, the fact is Christ had to die. Are we listening? Verse 36, the soldiers also mocked him, saying, and mocked him coming and offering sour wine and saying, if you are the king of the Jews, save yourself. I want you to notice how many times the word save is being used. Remember, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, save us now. What those people, the Romans and the soldiers and the priests and the crowds, what they failed to realize, even while they were saying, if you are the king of the Jews, save us now, that he was saving them. Oh, listen on. He wasn't saving himself. He was saving them. He had come not to save himself. Christ had come to offer himself to save the ones who were killing him. The world still laughs at Christ. I have a passion for Christ. You all know that. And nobody takes that away from me. Nobody. You could be the closest family in the world, Christ and Christ alone. There will be no compromise.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Do I have praise the Lord, somebody? Come on, church.
Lord.
Praise the Lord. If you're a compromising Christian, you're not a Christian.
Right.
You must stand the ground, Christ and Christ only. Don't be one of the crowds. Don't be one in the crowd, sorry. Don't be one in the crowd. It's Christ. You know, I admire the Christians who give up their lives for Christ. You know, they are approached by the Muslim, repent, believe in Allah or we kill you. And the Christian says, I will never believe in Allah. Go ahead and kill me. Huh? Well, here we go. Psh, head off. Next. Head off. Next. Let's get all the heads off. They will not denounce Christ. Because they know who Christ is.
Amen.
A lot of Christians in America don't know who Christ is.
Right.
Let me get that straight to you. A lot of Christians in America are seed warmers.
Yes.
They come to have a great time. Hey, didn't worship was a great time. And didn't you? Oh, well, it was a wonderful thing you did. Blah, 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 blah. Will you give your life to Christ? Start thinking. Yeah. The soldiers mocked him. Hey, you're the king? You're the king? Save yourself, king. Then there was written, and this is why Luke's account is so important. An inscription was written in three languages, Greek, Latin, and Hebrew. Why those three languages? Because those were the three main languages of this time. And the people who were gathered there during the Passover season would be speaking either all three or one of the three. Therefore, in order, the Lord obviously orchestrated this event, in order that nobody missed the connection, the sign was in three languages. This Is Yeshua King of the Jews? And even though the sign then was written as a mockery, as a sham, little did they understand that that statement is 100% true.
Amen.
Amen.
He is Yeshua, the King of the Jews. And for the Jews who were responsible for his murder, and for the Roman soldiers who were responsible for his murder, and for all the other people who were responsible for the murder, including people today, the statement or the inscription above his head, "This is Yeshua, the King of the Jews," still remains true.
Yes.
He is the King of the Jews, and he's coming back. He's coming back as the King of the Jews, but he's coming back more than that, as the King of the universe.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Verse 39, "And one of the criminals who were hanged blasphemed him, saying, 'If you are the Christ,'" Christ, the Messiah, the anointed one, "if you are HaMashiach, save yourself and us." But the other answering rebuked him, saying, "Do you not even fear God?" A thief rebuking a thief. Boy, is that irony or what? Two thieves, two different perspectives. One who understands who that man in the middle is, and one who is just as evil as all the rest of them who murdered him. "Don't you even fear God, seeing you're under the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." And then he said to Yeshua, "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Every time I read those words, they strike awe in me. "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." This man didn't study the Bible. I don't know. I don't think he was a biblical scholar. But something told him that this man in the middle was not ordinary. Something told him, maybe it was his study of the Tanakh. Maybe he was a witness to some of the miracles Christ had done. Maybe he was in the multitudes sometime when Christ fed the 5,000 or 10,000 or whatever. Maybe he was there. Maybe he saw lepers healed. Maybe he saw the blind given sight. Maybe he saw the mute speaking. And maybe all those things came back to his memory. And maybe, most importantly, God revealed something to him. He says, "Lord, when you come into your kingdom, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." This man knew more than the Pharisees, more than the chief priests, more than the elders, more than the Roman soldiers. That this man who was the Messiah, the one who was being crucified, this thief knew he was a king.
Yes.
Otherwise, he wouldn't say, "When you come into your kingdom."
Right.
If you have a kingdom, then you must be a king.
Right.
Praise his holy name.
Praise the name.
And Jesus said to him, what wonderful words we like Christ to say to everyone. "Assuredly, I say to you today, you shall be with me in paradise."
Hallelujah.
Glory.
Thank you, Lord.
"You shall be with me in my kingdom." Let that sink into your hearts. You see, there are many people who will not be in the kingdom of God. Why not? Because you don't believe in Christ. Christ does have a kingdom. He's coming back. You know, what's amazing about this encounter here is just very simple. That even as Christ was dying on the cross, and having refused to save himself from the cross, which he could have done, never forget, any moment, Christ could have simply, miraculously, gotten off that cross and walked away from it all. But had Christ chosen to walk away from that cross, you and I could never be in the kingdom of God. We could never have salvation. This is a doctrine that's hard to understand and hard to accept. Let me be clear. I didn't make up the doctrine. The Bible makes it very clear that all human beings are condemned to eternal destruction. Did you know that?
Yeah.
There's condemnation for all human beings until you receive the sacrifice of Christ.
Yeah.
Glory.
Only then your condemnation is removed. And you're no longer under condemnation. The condemnation is permanently removed. It's like delete. Now you have life. So Christ saved the very same thing. Remember a few days before? Hosanna, save us now. Christ saved the thief on the cross right there. He was saving. Dearly beloved, let's understand the whole story here. Summary. What did Christ come to do on that first visit? He had come to die for the sins of the world to save mankind. So the cry of the multitudes, Hosanna, save us, is absolutely correct. He had come to save. But the first salvation was going to be spiritual. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So in that spiritual salvation, very simple. Anybody, Jew and Roman, Gentile, Muslim, Hindu, anybody, atheist, black, white, green, yellow, short, fat, ugly, handsome, I don't care whatever you want to call yourself. Anybody, any nation can come to Christ and be saved.
Glory.
Why would people not come to Christ? Well, that's a different sermon for a different time. But he is the king. Jesus is the king. Yeshua is the king of the Jews. Amen?
Amen.
He died that day. He was crucified. It wasn't a death. No, he was crucified. We know the sermon he gave on the mount. I can't go through all the seven statements. But Christ preached the greatest sermon on the cross, from the cross. Exactly why he had come. And then he died. But the good news is he resurrected. Amen? The good news is that exactly as he said, 3 days later, he resurrected.
Thank you, Lord.
But the best news is he's coming back.
Yes.
Is he not?
Yes.
Listen well. The prophets of the Old Testament prophesied that one day this king will rule over Israel. They were expecting that prophet, this Jesus, to be that person. And they are right, except that their timing was wrong. Christ did come to rule. But before he occupies the kingly position of ruling the universe, he had first to pay the price for the ones he would redeem.
Mm-hmm.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
That's you and me.
Yep.
That's all those who surrender to Christ. And then he will come back. This world is about to be headed into the greatest disaster in the history of humanity. This world is rapidly approaching the no return point, if we can put it that way. When all the armies of the world are going to gather together against the city of Jerusalem. Christians are being slaughtered by the thousands and by the millions more and more. King Jesus is still there on the throne at the right hand of God the Father, and he's looking. He's not asleep, you know. Oh, the Muslims may think he's asleep, the politicians may think he's asleep, but he's far more alive than they are.
Amen.
He's planning his big day, his return. And when he comes, it's going to be a different Jesus coming. Different in what sense? Same Jesus, different purpose. Same Yeshua, different purpose. This time he comes, and there will no need for inscription to be written to Jesus, King of the Jews. He will come and prove himself King of the Jews. Israel will be so embroiled in a struggle for their survival. And all the nations of the world will forsake Israel. The Christians would have been raptured by then. We will be in Christ when the great marriage supper, and we await that glorious day when he says, okay, team, we are going back down to earth. We're not going there to be slaughtered. We're not going riding on a donkey. We are going on some white horses. Hallelujah. And he's coming back as the King of Kings. And he's coming back as the Lord of Lords. And he's coming back as the mighty conqueror. And all the world will submit unto this Jesus, King of the Jews, King of the universe. Now, where will you be? The question is, where will you be? I know where I'll be. I'll be with him. Because I believe in his work. And I accept his sacrifice. Not because I'm better than anybody, but simply because I'm smart enough to accept his sacrifice.
Amen.
Dearly beloved, those of you listening to me, Christ is offering you the gift of salvation right now. Receive Christ into your life this Holy Week, this Passover season, and be assured of a position in the kingdom of God when the King of Kings and Lord of Lords returns. Amen, amen, and amen. God bless you, everyone. Hallelujah.
Thank you.